Good afternoon. In the last session, I have explained the different types of direction control valves. There are different types of DC valves. Sliding spool valve, and rotary spool valve. In the case of sliding spool valve, due to the sliding of a spool inside the valve body, the number of ports made on valve body can be opened and closed. Depending upon the number of ports and positions, the sliding spool valves are again classified into 2x2 DC valve, 3x2 DC valve, 4x2, 4x3, 5x2, and 5x3. In the case of 2x2 DC valve, two ports are made on the valve body and there are two positions to open and close the ports. In the case of 3x2, three ports and two positions. In the case of 4x2, four ports and two positions. In 4x3, four ports and three positions are made. And in 5x2, five ports and two positions. In 5x3, five ports and three positions. The symbolic representation of 2x2 DC valve . Each position is represented by a box. Since it is having two boxes, two positions are required to change the ports. And in each position, there are two ports, port B and A. The direction of flow is represented by an arrow in the first position. This is the first position. And the flow takes place from pressure port to the working port. A is the working port, which is connected to the end of actuator. B is the pressure port, which is connected to the pump. And in the first position, since B and A are connecting, fluid flows easily from B to A, and some useful work is done by the actuator in the first position of DC valve. For actuating this DC valve, number of controlling elements are there. Push button is one type of actuating. By pressing the push button, B and A are connected. So both the ports are opened by the sliding spool and fluid flows from pump to the working port easily. Whenever push button is released, then there is second position. Because of return spring, it comes back. And the pressure port is closed. When the port is closed, no fluid flows from the pressure port to the working port. And this is a symbolic representation of the closing of ports. There are two positions and two ports made on the valve body. That's why it is a 2x2 DC valve. In the case of 3x2, two positions and three ports are made. In the first position, port B and A are opened and fluid flows from B to A. The direction of arrow represents indicates direction of flow. And the T is closed. T is the exhaust port, which is closed in the first position of a sliding spool valve. Whenever push button is released, then A is connected to working port, connected to T, and P is closed. In the second position, direction of flow is from actuator to the tank reservoir, but P is closed in the second position. So fluid flows from P to A in the first position, and in the second position, fluid is returned back to the reservoir from A to T, and P is closed in the second position. This is a symbolic representation of a 3/2 TC valve. In the case of 4/2, there are two positions. In the first position, connection is made from B to A, and another connection is made from B to D. Since all the ports are open, but the connection is made only from B to A, one working port. And in the same stroke, B connected to T. Now, from B to A, fluid enters the end of cylinder, some work is done. The fluid present at the other end of piston is returned back to the reservoir from B to T. This is the first position. By releasing the push button, the direction of flow of fluid is the reversed. Fluid flows from B to B and it returns from A to T. In the second position, the direction of flow is the reversed. So, in both the directions, piston can be reciprocated in the actuator. This is a symbolic representation of a 4/2 DC valve since it is having two positions. 4/3. In the case of 4/3 DC valve, there are three positions which is represented by three boxes. In the first position, B connected to A and B connected to T. In the first position, in this case, the extension of cylinder takes place. In the actuator, the extension takes place. And this is the first position. In the second position, the direction of flow is reversed. Fluid flows from A to B and return back from A to T. Second position. And in the case of neutral position, whenever handover is in neutral position, most commonly 4/3 DC valves are actuated by a hand lever, not push button. Push button is used only for 2/2 and 3/2 DC valves. In the case of 4/3 DC valve, whenever the sliding spool is in neutral position, all the ports are closed. Port P, D, A, and P. All the ports are closed and no work is done by the actuator. And this is called the neutral position of DC valve. And it is the representing the symbol of representing the 4/3 DC valve. 5/2. Similarly, in the case of 5/2 DC valve, there are two positions and five ports are made on the valve body. There are two tank ports, one pressure port, and A and B are working ports. Always the maximum of two working ports are there on the valve body. And only one pressure port is there, but two tank ports are there, two exhaust ports. In the first position, fluid flows from B to A and returns from B to T. And another T, it is closed, it remains closed by the spool plug. By means of plug, this port is closed in the first position. And in the second position, P is connected to B and A connected to T, and another tank port, it remains closed. Now, in the first position, one of the tank port is closed, and in the second position, another tank port is closed, and also the direction of flow is reversed in two positions. This is the representation of a 5x2 DC valve. In the case of 5x3 DC valve, there are three positions, because since it is having a three positions, three boxes. In the first box, first position is represented V to A. Fluid is sent back from V to T, and one tank port is closed. In the second position, direction of flow is reversed. It flows from V to B, returned back from A to T, and another tank port remains closed in the second position. And in the neutral position, the middle box always represents neutral position. No work is done by actuator. In the neutral position, all the ports are closed. No fluid flows to the actuator, and all the ports are closed. And the middle box always represents neutral position. This is the representation of a 5x3 DC valve. And in the case of a rotary spool valve, its working principle is the same as a 4x2 DC valve. But instead of using a sliding spool, the rotary can be used to open and close the ports. A rotor can be used. It is the only difference between the rotary spool valve and a 4x2 DC valve. Its working principle is same as 4x2 DC valve. Another type of control valve, which is used in the hydraulic systems, we know that there are three types of control valves used in hydraulic systems: pressure control valves, direction control valves, and flow control valves. In the case of pressure control valves, the pressure of a fluid which is entering the actuator can be controlled. And pressure control valves are needed to, whenever the load is varying, and according to the load, pressure must also be varied. It is done by pressure control valve. In the case of direction control valve, the direction of flow of a fluid which enters the actuator can be changed, can be reversed. The path of flow can be changed by using direction control valves. Another type of control valve used in a hydraulic system, a flow control valve. Symbol for representing a flow control valve What is the necessity of using a flow control valve in hydraulic circuit? Suppose the final element of hydraulic system is a linear actuator in which the piston can reciprocate in the cylinder. At the end of piston rod, there is a load. At the end of cylinder, a connection is made to the flow control valve. From the flow control valve, there is a DC valve. It has two or three positions. Before that, there is a pump. Whatever load is the speed of moving of load is to be varied. It is done by a flow control valve or throttle valve. The speed of load which is moving the actuator can be increased by opening of a flow control valve. Speed can be reduced by closing of flow control valve. Therefore, the main function of a flow control valve is to change the speed of load which is moved by an actuator. The actuator is the final element of any hydraulic system. It may be linear actuator or a rotary actuator. In the case of rotary actuator, the speed of rotation can also be altered by changing the rate of flow. rate of flow can be controlled by flow control valve. Whenever rate of flow increases, speed of load also increases. It is done by flow control valve. There are different types of flow control valves. Let us discuss the different types of flow control valves. Flow control valve is used to control the flow rate in the system according to system design. The quantity of fluid which enters the actuator can be controlled. The rate of flow means the quantity of fluid flowing. Its unit is a meter cube per second. Volume of fluid flowing per unit time. Flow rate is controlled by the throttling or diverting. There are two methods of controlling the rate of flow, either by throttling. Throttling means by opening or closing of valve. Diverting means some quantity of fluid can be returned back to the reservoir. This is also a method of changing flow rate. Throttling means by using the orifice, throttle valves, etc. And diverting means bypassing it to reservoir using the flow control valve. There are two methods of changing the rate of flow. One is just by throttling, by opening or closing the screw, it can be controlled. Or some of the fluid which is diverted to the reservoir, rate of flow can also be changed. The symbol for representing a flow control valve is shown in figure. Basic function of a flow control valve is to reduce the rate of flow, in its leg of hydraulic circuit. One of the most important applications of flow control valves in hydraulic system is controlling the flow rate through cylinders and motor. There are two types of actuators. I already told you there are different types of actuators used in hydraulic system: hydraulic cylinder and hydraulic motor. In the case of hydraulic cylinder, load is moved in a straight line, either vertically or horizontally or at an angle. But always load can be moved in a straight line. In the case of hydraulic motors, there is a rotary motion. Rotation of a rotor is a hydraulic motor. In both the cases, the flow control valves are used to regulate the speed. Any reduction in flow will in turn result in a speed reduction at the actuator. Whenever rate of flow is altered, speed is also changed. There are many different designs of valves used for controlling flow. Many of these designs have been developed to meet specific needs. Different types of flow control valves. The first type, a ball check valve. A ball check valve is a check valve in which the closing member, the movable part to block the flow, is a ball. Initially, the ball is closing the inlet port initially. But there is a return spring. By means of a spring force, ball is closing the port. In some ball check valves, the ball is spring loaded to help keep it shut. In the first portion, automatically the port is closed by the ball by means of spring force. The interior surface of the main seats of ball check valves are more or less conically tapered. The port is a tapered shape to guide the ball into seat. It is also known as a check valve or non-return valve because it allows the flow of fluid only in one direction. In a reverse direction, ball automatically closes the port. So it is a type of non-return valve. Gate valve. Second type of flow control valve is a gate valve. A three-dimensional view is shown in figure, which consists of a plate. The plate can be moved vertically by rotating the hand wheel. A gate valves are used to shut off the flow of fluids rather than for flow regulation. They can completely close the flow of fluid by means of gate valves. The size of the open flow path generally varies in a non-linear manner as the gate is moved. This is not having a linear property. Non-linear property, because rate of flow cannot be changed linearly by using the gate valves. This means that the flow rate does not change evenly with the stem travel. Depending on the construction, a partially open gate can vibrate from the fluid flow. Whenever gate is opened partially, it may have some vibrations. That is the main disadvantage of using gate valve. And also, the flow rate may not be uniform. Gate valves are mostly used with large pipe diameters from 2 inches to the largest pipeline. If the diameter of pipe is greater than 2 inches, then only gate valves are most suitable. It is not suitable for small diameter pipes, since they are less complex to construct than other types of valves in larger size. Another type of flow control valve, a needle valve. Needle valve is a type of valve with a small port and a threaded needle-shaped plunger. This is threaded needle-shaped plunger, which can be moved horizontally by rotating the lever. And there are two ports made in the pipeline. This is the inlet port and this is the exhaust port, outlet port. Whenever the lever is rotated in one direction, needle can be moved in the left direction, then port is open. If suppose the rate of flow is to be decreased, then what happens is lever is rotated in another direction, which moves the needle in towards right, thereby closing the port partially. Then the rate of flow from inlet to the outlet is slightly reduced. Like this, the needle valve construction is made. And here, the rate of flow, wide range of rate of flow can be obtained by a needle valve. An instrument needle valve uses a tapered pin to gradually open a space for fine control of flow. Fine control of flow is possible only by a needle valve. It's not possible by other type of flow control valves like gate valve and ball check valve. A needle valve has a relatively small orifice. There is a small orifice made in the pipeline with a long tapered seat. Its end is tapered in shape, and a needle shaped plunger on the end of a screw which exactly fits the seat. It is about the flow control valves. In general, flow control valve is a type of control valve by which the rate of flow or quantity of fluid which enters the end of cylinder can be regulated. Its main function is to change the speed of a load, either by in a linear actuator or rotary actuator. The speed of moving the load can be altered by changing the rate of flow. The change of rate of flow is done by a control valve known as flow control valve. We have discussed the three types of control valves. This is about flow control valve. In any hydraulic system, I already told you in the last session, there are three types of control valves: pressure control valve, direction control valve, and flow control valves. And we have discussed all the different types of control valves. Now, the main component of any hydraulic system is actuator. It is the last component, and by means of actuator only, the fluid power is converted into mechanical power. And our aim is to convert the fluid power into mechanical power. So actuator is the very important component of any hydraulic system. Hydraulic systems are used to control and transmit power. It may be a linear movement or a rotary movement. Its function is just opposite to the pump. In the case of pump, the mechanical energy converted into hydraulic energy, but in the case of actuator, fluid power is converted into mechanical energy.
A pump driven by prime mover, such as electric motor, creates a flow of fluid in which the pressure, direction, and flow rate are controlled by valves. A pump is necessary to increase the pressure of fluid from inlet to the outlet. Pump increases the pressure. For running of a pump, there must be a prime mover. Most commonly used prime mover is electric motor. An AC induction motor is the most commonly used to run the pump. The pump may be reciprocating pump or a rotary pump. Depending upon the construction and the principle of working, the pumps are classified. Pump is driven by electric motor. Whenever pump is driving, it sucks the fluid at low pressure at its inlet, and pressure of fluid is increased and discharges through its outlet. Every pump is having inlet and outlet. At the inlet, pressure is low. At the outlet, pressure becomes very high. Very high pressure is required to run the actuator. That is the main function of pump. From the pump, it goes to direction the pressure control valve. Pressure of flow, pressure of fluid can be regulated by pressure control valve. From the pressure control valve, fluid goes to direction control valve to change the direction of flow of fluid into actuator. I told you that different types of direction control valves. And after the direction control valve, fluid goes to flow control valves to vary the flow rate. I told you there are reasons for changing pressure, direction, and the flow rate also. An actuator is used to convert the energy of fluid back into mechanical power. The amount of output power developed depends upon the flow rate, pressure drop across the actuator. At high pressure, fluid enters the cylinder or actuator at high pressure and finally discharges at low pressure. The pressure difference between inlet and outlet is converted into equivalent mechanical energy. It is done by actuator. The work done or output power depends upon the pressure of inlet and outlet in the actuator. When pressure is high, pressure difference is high, then more work is done, more power is developed by the actuator. Thus, they are devices which are used to convert pressure energy of fluid into mechanical energy. Different types of actuators. Depending on the type of actuation, hydraulic actuators are classified as linear and rotary and semi-rotary actuators. Linear actuator, example hydraulic cylinder, in which the load can be moved in a straight line. For linear actuation means straight line. Rotary actuator, example hydraulic motor. In hydraulic motor, fluid power converted into the rotary movement, rotary actuation. It may be unidirectional motor or bidirectional motor, depending upon the direction of rotation. Again, they are classified into unidirectional and bidirectional. Semi-rotary actuator. Semi-rotary actuator, actuator rotates only for a limited angle, not full rotation. For limited angle of actuation, semi-rotary actuators are used. Hydraulic linear actuators. As their name implies, it provides motion in a straight line. The total movement is a finite amount determined by the construction of the unit. This is very important. In the linear actuator, there is a cylinder inside which a piston reciprocates, and the total distance moved by the load depends upon the size of cylinder, the two stroke length of cylinder. By increasing the stroke length, distance moved by the load can also be increased. They are referred to as cylinders, rams, and jacks. Hydraulic cylinder or hydraulic rams and hydraulic jacks. The function of hydraulic cylinder is to convert the hydraulic power into linear mechanical force or motion. Hydraulic cylinder extend and retract a piston rod to provide a pull or push force to drive the external load along a straight path. There are two directions. Work is done in two directions by means of hydraulic cylinders. One is extension and another is retraction. In the case of extension, load is pushed, and in the case of retraction, load is pulled back. Extension is the forward stroke of piston, and retraction is the return stroke of piston. Types of hydraulic cylinders. Hydraulic cylinders are classified depending upon the pressure acting on the end of piston. Single acting, double acting cylinder, telescopic and tandem cylinders. You have in your syllabus the single acting cylinders and double acting cylinders. In the case of single acting cylinder, pressure of fluid acts only on one end of piston. In the case of double acting cylinders, the pressure of fluid acts on both the ends of piston. First type of hydraulic cylinder, single acting. The constructional features of single acting cylinder is shown in figure, which consists of a barrel cylinder inside which the port is made. Only one port is made, which is both inlet and outlet port, which can be used as both inlet and outlet port. And there is a piston which can reciprocate inside the cylinder. And there is a piston rod. At the end of piston rod, load can be attached or load can be moved. Now, to prevent the leakage of fluid between the walls of cylinder and the piston seal is also provided, which prevents the flow of fluid from the leakage of fluid can be prevented by the piston seal. Symbol representing single acting cylinder. Load can be moved in both the directions like this. There is a inlet port through which fluid is entering, and there is a return spring which is attached to another end of piston. Whenever the pressure of fluid acts on one end of piston, piston is moved. Piston is pushing, and this stroke is a forward stroke or extension. This is called extension. In the extension, the load is pushing. That's why for pushing action, this type of single acting cylinders are used. There is also a vent is provided. Its main function is fluid is not present at the other end of piston. The air present at the other end of piston can be exhausted through a vent hole. For that, a vent hole is provided at the other end of a cylinder. The symbolic representation of a single acting cylinder, the two for push action, because load is pushing. In the first diagram, load is pushing. This is a symbol for representing a push action single acting cylinder. And it has only one port that is shown in figure, in the symbol. Second diagram illustrates single acting cylinder for pull action. For pulling of load towards the cylinder, this is the arrangement. The inlet port is made at the right end of cylinder, and a spring is attached at the left end of piston. Whenever fluid enters the end of a piston can be moved towards left, and the load can be pulled. It is shown symbolically like this, symbolic representation of a pull action single acting cylinder. Single acting cylinder consists of a piston inside hydraulic housing called as barrel. The cylinder body can also be called as a barrel. On one end is attached a rod which can reciprocate. There are two ends of a cylinder, namely blank end and rod end. This is a blank end. Its cylinder is completely closed at one of its ends. This is a blank end. At the other end, piston rod can be moved. That's why another end of a cylinder can also be called as rod end. They produce force only in one direction by hydraulic pressure acting on the piston. always single acting cylinder can produce force only in one direction. In the other direction, the retraction takes place by return spring, by spring force. That's why work cannot be done in retraction. Only in the extension load can be moved. Power is developed only in extension, and the retraction is done automatically by return spring. No work is done. That's why power is developed only in one side of piston. The return of spring is not done hydraulically. It is either done by gravity or spring. Whenever spring is not used, the piston can be returned back through by gravity. Whenever the cylinder is mounted vertically, cylinder can come back by gravity. And when the cylinder is horizontal, there may be a spring. Stroke length of single acting cylinder is limited to 100 mm due to natural length of the spring. There is a limit for the distance moved by the load. In single acting cylinder, the maximum distance moved is only 100 mm because the length of size of a spring available is only maximum 100 mm. So depending upon this length of a spring, the stroke length can be, stroke length is according to the length of spring used. But length of spring used is only maximum of 100 mm. That's why it is limited to 100 mm. Distance moved by the load is limited to 100 mm in the case of single acting cylinder. The exhaust air on the piston rod side is vented through the train hole. I told you the meaning of a train hole. The air present at the other end of piston exhausted through vent hole. It cannot be used for the entry of fluid. The single acting cylinder is suitable for the applications such as cutting, clamping, pressing, lifting and feeding. Instead of moving the load, whenever the saw is fitted, it can be used for cutting the object. For clamping purpose also, single acting cylinders can be used. Pressing operations, lifting of load vertically, loads can be lifted by means of single acting cylinder. And feeding is nothing but, for example, in a machine tool, suppose the work table is moved and a tool is rotating. In that case, the feed of table, movement of table can be done by single acting cylinder. In some machine tools, table is stationary, that is workpiece is stationary, whereas a tool can be moved. The moving of a tool can be done by a single acting cylinder. It's the meaning of feeding. Another type of cylinder, hydraulic cylinder, double acting cylinder. In the double acting cylinder, the pressure of fluid acts on both sides of piston. That's why it is a double acting cylinder. When one of the port becomes inlet, another port becomes outlet. Again, double acting cylinders are classified into the single piston rod on one side or piston rod on both sides. In both the cases, two ports are made. The constructional features of a double acting cylinder are shown in figure, which consists of a barrel inside which piston reciprocates. There is a piston rod. Two ports are made on the valve body. Two ports are made. In the first diagram, this becomes inlet and another port becomes outlet. Fluid enters at the inlet and the fluid is exhausted through its outlet port. At both the ends, fluid is present. When pressure is acting at one side, the fluid returned back through its outlet. In the second diagram, fluid enters at the right end of a cylinder and returned back through its left end. So in the first diagram, the first port becomes inlet, second port becomes outlet. Second diagram, second port becomes inlet, first port becomes outlet. And pressure can act on both sides of piston. That's why it is a double acting cylinder. Both for extension and retraction, work can be done. It is the main advantage of using double acting cylinder. But in the case of single acting cylinder, work is done only in one direction during extension only. But in double acting cylinder, load can be moved in both the directions, both in extension and retraction, because of the flow of fluid in both the directions. Double acting cylinder with piston rod on one side. To extend the cylinder, the pump flow is sent to the blank end port as shown in figure. The fluid from the rod end port returns to the reservoir. In the first diagram, at the blank end, fluid enters. At the rod end, fluid is returned to the reservoir. Now, to retract the cylinder, the pump flow is sent to the rod end port and the fluid from the blank end port returns to the tank. It is just opposite. For extension and retraction, the direction of flow of a fluid is reversed. Now, double acting cylinder with a piston rod on both sides. This is very important for moving the load in both the directions simultaneously. Whenever a fluid flows from its right end and fluid is returned back through its left end. In this case, retraction takes place. In the retraction, load can be moved towards left at the left end, and in both directions load can be moved. Whenever load is connected to the piston rods, load can be moved in the direction at both the ends. And by changing the direction of flow of fluid, load can be moved in towards right, that is the extension. In the extension also, load can be moved by both the piston rods simultaneously. This is the main advantage of using a double acting cylinder with two piston rods. To extend the cylinder, the pump flow is sent to the blank end port as shown in figure. A double acting cylinder with piston on both sides is a cylinder with a rod extending from both the ends. The extension takes place in both the ends of piston rod. The application involves in a process where work can be done by both the ends of cylinder, thereby making the cylinder more productive. The rate of production can also be increased. It is almost doubled compared to a double cylinder with a single piston rod, because power is developed at both the ends of a piston. That's why its production is doubled. Double rod cylinder can withstand higher side loads because they have an extra bearing on each rod to withstand the loading. Symbols for representing hydraulic cylinders. The first diagram shows single acting cylinder with unspecified return. Here, spring is not used. In some cases, single acting cylinders without a spring can also be used. But in the return stroke, for the retraction of piston returned back by gravity. This is most suitable for the vertical cylinders. It cannot be used for horizontal cylinders. By gravity, piston comes back during retraction. But in extension, fluid enters the end of a piston. Second diagram shows a single acting cylinder with a spring return. There is a return spring by means of which the retraction takes place. Double acting cylinder with single piston rod. There is a single piston rod and two ports are made on the ends of a cylinder and pressure acts on both ends of piston. Double acting cylinder with a double piston rod. Because piston rod is placed at both ends of piston, it is shown in figure. This is about hydraulic actuators. There are two types of actuators, cylinders and motors, hydraulic cylinder and hydraulic motor. Again, hydraulic cylinders are classified into single acting and double acting, depending upon the pressure acting on the ends of piston. In the case of single acting cylinder, pressure acts only on one side of piston. In the case of double acting cylinder, pressure acts on both the ends of piston. Work can be done in both the directions. And again, double acting cylinders are classified into a single piston rod and double piston rod. In double piston rod, more power is produced by using a double piston rod. Rate of production can be increased. This is about hydraulic actuators, the two hydraulic cylinders. The second type of hydraulic actuator is a hydraulic motor. As its name implies, it is the working principle is same as the electric motor. In electric motor, the input is electric power and output is rotation of shaft. Similarly, in the hydraulic motor, input is the fluid power and output is rotation of shaft. Since the power is a rotary power is developed by actuator, it is known as hydraulic motor. Hydraulic motor produce rotation of shaft and torque when fluid and pressure is supplied. Depending upon the direction of rotation, they are classified into unidirectional and bidirectional motors. In the case of unidirectional hydraulic motor, motor rotates only in one direction. It may be clockwise or anti-clockwise. In the case of bidirectional motor, fluid is passed on the periphery of rotor in both the directions, so direction of rotation can also be reversed. It can be rotated in both the directions in the case of a bidirectional hydraulic motor. In all the hydraulic motors, the basic principle is fluid is supplied on the surface of a motor by means of a number of, depending upon the construction, their principle of working, number of hydraulic motors are there. I will tell you later different types of hydraulic motors. It is similar, its working principle is same as electric motor. Hydraulic motors are back driven. Types of hydraulic motors: gear motor, vane motors, piston motors, and gear rotor motor. Depending upon the construction and principle of working, hydraulic motors are classified. The first type of hydraulic motor, gear motor. Earlier, I explained the working principle of hydraulic gear pumps. In the case of gear pumps, whenever driving and driven gears are rotating in opposite directions, a suction is developed at its inlet, and because of a suction, fluid is sucked into the inlet, and this fluid is pressure is increased by the rotation of gears in both directions, because the fluid is trapped between the two teeth which are made on the periphery of gears. The fluid which is trapped between the space, its pressure is gradually increasing, and finally high pressure fluid is produced at its outlet and discharges at its outlet. This is a basic principle of working of any gear pump. And here it is opposite to gear pump. Principle of working is opposite to gear pump. In the case of gear motor, instead of suction at its inlet, high pressure fluid is passing through its inlet. High pressure fluid is passing at its inlet. Before that, the pressure is increased. By means of pump, pressure is increased. And before that, there is a direction control valve, because this is the actuator. High pressure fluid enters the inlet, and because of high pressure, it makes the movement of teeth. The teeth made on driving and driven gears are moved by the fluid, because the fluid is having a very high pressure. Due to the movement of gear teeth, gears will rotate in the same direction. When gears are rotating in the same direction, the pressure goes on reducing from inlet to the outlet, and at low pressure, discharges through its outlet port. It is just opposite to gear pump. In the case of gear pump, inlet pressure is less and outlet pressure is very high. But in the case of gear motor, inlet pressure is very high, outlet pressure is low. The pressure difference between inlet and outlet is converted into the mechanical rotary motion of gears. In the case of gear and vane motors are used in simple rotating system. Their benefits include a low initial cost and high RPM. High pressure oil is ported into one side of the gears, that is inlet. High pressure oil is supplied, where it flows around the periphery of the gears. Around the periphery of gears means in the space between the two gear teeth, fluid is flowing between the gear tips and the wall housing in which it resides to the outlet port. Fluid is passing from inlet to the outlet between the space between the gears. Fluid is flowing. Now pressure is gradually decreasing from inlet to the outlet. As the pressure is decreasing proportionately, it is converted into the rotary movement of gears. And one more important point is, shaft is mounted only for one gear. Even though two gears are used, power is converted only in one gear. But only to the one gear, the shaft is fitted. Shaft can be rotated by one of them, one of the gears. An especially positive attribute of the gear motor is that catastrophic breakdown is less common than in most other types of hydraulic motors. Vane motor. Another type of hydraulic motor is a vane motor. There is a rotor on which, on the surface of which, a number of slots are made, and inside the slots, by means of a spring, number of blades are fitted. Number of blades are fitted like this. This is a rotor. The rotor is a circular member, on the surface of which number of slots are made, and in all these slots, number of blades are fitted by means of springs. And springs are touching the cam ring. This is a cam ring. Around the rotor, there is a cam ring. And on the surface of cam ring, there is a casing. And casing is having two ports, inlet port and outlet port. This is the inlet port, and these two are outlet ports. High pressure fluid is made to enter through its inlet. When high pressure fluid enters the inlet, then vanes will rotate. Vanes will move. Inside the cam ring, vanes are moving. When vanes are moving due to pressure of fluid, then due to the movement of vanes, rotor will rotate because the blades are fitted in the slots of rotor. Since the blades are moving, rotor will rotate in the same direction, and gradually the pressure of fluid is decreased and finally discharges through its outlet. But rotor will rotate. The rotation of rotor is mechanical power, mechanical rotary motion. Like this, by means of vane motors, power can be produced. It is about hydraulic motors. Gear motor and vane motors are most commonly used. In the case of gear motors, fluid enters at high pressure at its inlet, and while passing between the gear teeth and the periphery of casing, the pressure gradually decreases from its inlet to the outlet, and the difference of pressure is converted into mechanical rotary motion. It is the main principle of working of any gear motor. There are two gears. Gears are meshing together, meshing with each other. And one more factor is, in between the gears, fluid should not enter. There is no clearance. There should not be any clearance between the mating of these gears. This is a very important point. If clearance is there, then directly fluid flows directly from inlet to the outlet through this clearance. It should not be there. In the case of vane motors, spring-loaded vanes are connected to a rotor. I told you, spring-loaded vanes means number of slots are made on the surface of a rotor. Inside the slots, there are springs. For each spring, a connection is made to the blade or vane, and the vanes are touching the cam ring. Vanes are touching the outer end of blades are touching the cam ring, as shown in figure. But the cam ring is fitted inside the casing. Casing is having a number of ports, two inlets and two outlet ports. Simultaneously, high pressure fluid is passing through both the inlets. Because of high pressure fluid, the blades will move. Blades will move and pressure of fluid gradually decreases from inlet to the outlet. And finally, fluid discharges through its outlet. Due to the movement of vanes or blades, rotor will rotate. So, fluid power is converted into a mechanical rotary motion. So, these are different types of hydraulic motors. This is the end of this session. In this session, we have discussed many aspects like and different types of direction control valves, different types of flow control valves, and hydraulic actuators, cylinders and motors. If you have any doubts, you can ask questions now.